अभी अभी आया, आई थिंक इट हैज कम, माइक हैज कम, ओके देन आई विल को मैंने बोल दिया एंड फर्स्ट लेट अस गेट सेटल डाउन. यू आर प्रेजेंटिंग. अभी क्या है कि अब कैन यू सी द प्रेजेंटेशन? You got it?
मेरा वो क्या कहते हैं, इसमें भी लो कर दो, डाउनलोड करो सो आई कैन सी माई फोटो एटलीस्ट. मतलब दिखने चाहिए ना. हाँ काट के
Okay, good evening everyone. Welcome, I welcome you all. Today we are having our IEEE Rajasthan subsection chairman, Professor Rohit Bhakar sir, and our principal sir, Dr. J.K. Digwal here, and Dr. Mahesh Kala, he is the just founder and CEO of JV Mechatronics. Digwal sir.
Good evening, sir. Please, Sanjeev.
Good evening, sir.
गुड इवनिंग सर.
काला जी कैसे हैं?
फाइन सर, परफेक्ट.
काला जी कैसे हैं?
आई एम फाइन सर, आई एम फाइन, थैंक यू. हाउ आर यू?
टू सी यू. आई एम फाइन,
थैंक्स, इट्स माय प्लेजर.
आई हार्टली वेलकम फ्रॉम द GWECA फैमिली एंड द IEEE फैमिली इन दिस पर्टिकुलर लेक्चर सीरीज, एंड टुडे यू आर डिलीवरिंग इन द RF एनेक्विन चैम्बर. And really, you have done a tremendous job at our GWECA. You have established the Anechoic Chamber, and that was the, I think that is the first chamber ever in the Rajasthan, in the Educational Institute. So, Roy sir, I also welcome you in this particular lecture series from the GWECA family.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Now, I request Mahesh Kalaji kindly give your lecture expertise field, the Anechoic Chamber, kindly, so that the young researchers, our faculty members, can learn about the basics of the Anechoic Chamber. Thank you. I again welcome you all.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank
now
you very much, sir.
Now I welcome Professor Rohit Bhakar sir, who is also the chairman of IEEE Rajasthan subsection as well as professor in electrical department, MNIT Jaipur. Today he is the moderator of this program. So I request Rohit Bhakar sir to say something.
First of all, I would like to thank Government Engineering College Ajmer for hosting this nice event. I feel it is a privilege that Government Engineering College is able to bring so leading entrepreneurs and who have got research aptitude to such platforms on IEEE platform, where a large number of audience, which I can see about 100 people, have joined the event. I think it is very much timely. Thank you, Kala sir, for joining us, because the need of the hour, both from academia, from the IEEE platform also, we see that the need of the hour is to inculcate entrepreneurship activities within the students, to understand how the industry is working and what are the actual industry requirements. Moreover, looking at the requirements of defense, I can see, I could see through your profile, and I see that the value that your industry and your research brings to the country, it cannot be counted in terms of money. It is a thing that we all need to learn, how to develop these mechanisms for the country, to make country a self-sufficient country. So I must thank you for joining and accepting our invitation for this event, and I'm sure the students would learn a lot, not only from the technical perspective, but also from an entrepreneurship perspective, how to take risk and how to go about developing an industry in these segments. So I think we all would be happy to hear from you. How do we, how can we go about all these things? Thank you for joining. Thank you, Government Engineering College, Dr. Sanjeev, for hosting this event. I'll be here for this event, hosting this event and coordinating that.
Okay, thank you, sir. Brief bio data of Professor JV Micronics, I have sent you.
Shall I start, Dr. Sanjeev?
No, no, sir, just hold on, sir. Rohit, sir, I have just sent WhatsApp. Yeah, I just sent you.
Okay.
I forgot.
Also, people would be more interested in listening to him directly.
Sir, I have sent you. Sorry for that.
Not a problem.
Yeah.
I can see that he has got a very vast experience, both in the industry. He was working with a lot of industry in the defense sector, I guess. He was head of the project for aircraft anaerobic chambers and head of projects for radar testing. I guess, sir, I'll welcome you directly for the program and for your speech. That would be more interesting for people to listen to that. Hello, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Hello, sir. Please start.
For appreciation. Okay, sir. Thank you very much, Al. And the topic of which was given me is to know about RF anaerobic chamber. Presenting.
I think voice is not clear.
Your voice is breaking a little bit.
And now is it okay, sir?
Yeah, now it's okay.
Okay. So the topic given to me is, do you know about the RF liquid chamber? And I'll be giving the basic understanding of RF liquid chamber and planning to prepare a requirement what exactly we need in RF liquid chamber. So that will be the takeaway from this presentation. I have a couple of slides regarding our company, JV Micronics. JV Micronics was incorporated in the year 2011, and we are manufacturing RF rods, RF anaerobic chambers, and antenna measurement systems. Antenna measurement system here means antenna positioners and softwares. We have supplied our products to various different labs of DRDO, different labs of ISRO, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, Bharat Electronics Limited, Samir, EQDC, Baba Atomic Research Center, Electronic Corporation of India, Indian Air Force, different IITs, NITs, many premium private and government colleges in India. We also worked with the private companies. We are happy to say that now so many private companies are venturing into the RF. Few big names with whom we have worked, we supplied our products, are Astra Microwave Private Limited, Avantel Limited, Huber Plus Schoner, Defsys, and many more in India. We have just added one MRO also, their MRO of MiG-29 naval version of aircraft. So they are also testing their radar in our anaerobic chamber. We are also exporting products to countries like USA, Poland, Turkey, Canada, Netherlands, Belgium, and even to China also. Presently, we are number one, as we have supplied highest numbers of anaerobic chambers in India in last 9 years of operation. Recently, we had a collaboration with a foreign company named as Antenna Systems and Solutions, which is in Spain. They will be supporting us with their products for near-field test ranges and compact antenna test ranges. measurement systems and software will be by this company, and Anikyo chamber will be supplied by JV Microonics. In present year, in the last year of 2019, we have been awarded by Times of India under Make in India category when they were celebrating 50 brands across industries that are building the nation in the category of EMI, EMC, Anikyo chamber and RF absorbers. The award was given by our Minister of State for MSME, Mr. P.C. Sarangi. Now, here comes the topic of the day, Anikyo chamber. An Anikyo chamber is a shielded room which is designed to attenuate waves. Anikyo chambers were originally used in context of acoustic echoes, which were caused by reflections from the internal surfaces of the room. But now, Anikyo chambers have been used to provide a shielded environment for radio frequency and microwaves. These both types of chambers are constructed with echo suppression features and with effective isolation from the acoustic or RF noise present in the external environment. An RF shielded Anikyo chamber is designed to suppress the electromagnetic wave from the internal surfaces too, and also called as non-echo chamber. So what we need inside any echo chamber, what we have to test, what we have to do, these are two very important personalities. One is shielding effectiveness and other is reflectivity of any echo chamber, that is quiet zone. My presentation is focused on these two properties. Shielding effectiveness, shielding of the chamber limits RF interferences from equipment or sources located outside of the chamber. It does not allow outside signals to come inside the chamber. Also, it will not allow inside RF signal to pollute the environment. It will not happen. Basically, it is an isolation between inside and outside of any chamber, which will be the shielding is obtained by metal structure room by using either galvanized iron sheets, aluminium sheets or copper sheets. Type of metal is selected depending upon the conductivity of metal at desired frequency and cost. Let me tell you, nowadays galvanized iron sheets are more popular as compared to aluminium and copper, because aluminium sheet has better conductivity up to 1 gigahertz and copper sheets are costlier. So galvanized iron sheets, which has a better conductivity in the complete RF microwave frequency range and are most cheapest. In olden days, chambers were made by using aluminium, mostly by aluminium and some by using copper. Shielding effectiveness is the requirement of the user to select limit. In modern time, it may normally selected between 50 dB to 110 dB. High shielding effectiveness is required in EMI, EMC and Anikyo chambers. For any chamber, shielding between 50 to 80 dB is fine. Actually, how to select it? It depends like whether you are staying in a rural area or in a city area. In city area, we will have a lot many RF noises because of many RF sources present. So in that situation, we go for higher shielding effectiveness. EMI EMC chamber will need more shielding effectiveness above 100 dB, especially for microwave frequency. But even 50 dB is better for antenna chamber. 50 dB to 80 dB is a perfect. This is as per our experience and the modern chamber now made. There are different types of shielding methods, which depends upon the types of panels for constructions of walls, roof and flooring. Now we have to select which type of shielding we want. Each methods have its advantages and disadvantages too. First, GI sheets of 2 mm thickness, welding GI sheets on mild steel mesh structure. Number two, using modular pan modules of 2 mm thick GI sheets, joining it by using RF metallic gaskets and hardware. Third one, modular sandwich panels of GI sheets having wood in between the 2 GI sheets, joining by using GI profile and hardware. In the third situation, wood is sandwiched between 2 layers of galvanized iron sheet. We will first go for the welded structure. A cage is made up of mild steel pipes angles beam is constructed. Means by using pipe, angle and beam, we have to construct my cage. And over the cage, GI sheet is welded on metal frame all around the six faces. Welding structure is best suitable as Indian condition, especially when the chamber is needed to be located at only one place. It is robust and cheapest as compared to others. Here we are. This is the cage we make for making the anechoic chamber. This cage is made up of mild steel structure. There are beams and columns and angles and pipes. It is all designed as per the strength and size of the anechoic chamber. After making the structure, GI sheets are welded from inside the room, and the shielded chamber will look like this. Number two, the pan module chamber. If anechoic chamber is required to be taken to a new place, then pan modules are preferable. Sometimes, a lot of our customers say, like, we need to move this anechoic chamber to our new building. That time, we propose them, and that is the intelligent time to use pan modules, as it can be dismantled and installed again to a new location by experienced installers. Pan modules are bolted together by using RF double bulb casket. How it looks? First, it is a GI sheet. A 90 degree bend is given, and then again one more 90 degree bend is given to form a pan. This will be having a bend from all the four sides. On the last bend, on this bend, there is a oblong cut structure for fixing the hardware. You can see here, these two sheets, these two panels are joined together by using RF gasket in between and nuts and bolts. We need to be very, very careful in fixing this. It looks simple, but it needs a specialization as the even a small dust will be a leakage point of RF, and that will be very dangerous for EMI and EMC. These panels are to be cleaned with the help of alcohol. Isopropyl alcohol is the best thing, after which we are using nowadays for cleaning our hands, sanitizing our hand. Alcohol is used for cleaning these pans also, so that these can be joined together and create a perfect conductive surface. You can see here, this is a gasket, which is a RF gasket is made up of copper and some metallic coating on it. It is a double bulb gasket. These are two bulbs, and in between there's a mesh of gasket. This bulb gasket will be placed in between these two panels. Shielded structure using sandwich panel. It is a wooden board sandwich between two GI sheets. Sandwich panels are joined together by using profile beams and RF gaskets. It is popular for EMI EMC shielded chamber. In India, welded chambers and pan module shielded chambers are more popular for antenna chambers, and for EMI and EMC chamber made with pan module as well as the sandwiched panels are used. You can see here, these are the sandwich panels. This portion is a wood, GI sheet, this side, all the GI sheet, they are joined together by using nut bolt and specially profile cut GI material. And the corner also, it is happening like this, and we make a perfect shield. Now, after knowing about the requirement of GI panels, what we have to use for our anechoic chamber, how we have to design, now we have to understand how this shield is working. Suppose this is my shielded chamber, which is completely sealed now. There is no leakage, and we have very good shielding effectiveness. Then when RF is striking over it, some portion of the RF will be reflected back, and some portion will be grounded. Grounding, it looks very simple here, but this is a very important personality who plays a very important role in making a better shielding effectiveness. I'll explain it in another slide. Yes, here we are. Grounding of anechoic chamber. Individual earthing to be provided other than the common earthing of building which is housing the chamber. That means inside the building we have a room, there will also have an earthing connection which is present in our supports, but we should not use it. We have to provide an individual earthing. Why we have to provide individual earthing? Because the earthing which is present in the building will be bringing a lot of noises inside the nuclear chamber. So that noise has to be eliminated by giving a perfect individual earthing for a nuclear chamber. This grounding of a nuclear chamber is to be done by using copper strip, and which should have earthing resistance less than 2 ohm. Maintenance-free chemical earthing is desirable. Nowadays, modern earthing is there, where maintenance is very, very less. Now, what are the accessories of shielded chamber, and why we should know about it, and how these are taking care of the shielding? Number one, the first is our shielded door. Entry door, honeycomb air conditioning vents. We need to bring air conditioner inside the nuclear chamber. That means we need honeycomb air conditioning vents, power line filters, access panel, emission-free lights, emission-free CCTV camera system, and RF gaskets. I will explain each one by one. Shielding effectiveness of shielded door. Shielding effectiveness of shielded door is achieved by mating between the brass knife edge extrusion of the door leaf and the concentric row of beryllium copper finger stock gasket mounted within the pocket extrusion on the door frame. So on the panel, we have a knife edge extrusion, and on the panel, we have a beryllium copper finger gaskets. Beryllium copper finger gaskets are highly flexible. When the knife edge is resting in between the two fingers, that time these two fingers be a flexible one, it will be holding the knife very strongly and it will not allow any hole or leakage of EM waves. The shielded room is only effective when your RF door is manufactured. Hello? Sir, I'm not hearing.
मैं सर सोच कि आपकी वॉइस क्लियर नहीं, थोड़ा सा सर योर वॉइस इज लिटिल बिट नॉट क्लियर.
ओके, शैल आई रिपीट नाउ द लास्ट?
या द पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर जस्ट राइटिंग दैट द वॉइस इज.
ओके, हाउ इज इट?
सर नाउ इट्स क्लियर. आई थिंक लिटिल बिट फास्ट यू आर स्पीकिंग, दैट्स व्हाई.
ओह
या, इट्स ओके नाउ, बट लिटिल बिट फास्ट, दैट्स व्हाई दे आर सेइंग. या
okay sir, okay, let me reduce my speed. So I will tell the shielding effectiveness of the door again. Shielding effectiveness of shielded door is achieved by mating between the brass knife edge extrusion of the door leaf and the concentric rows of beryllium copper finger stock gasket mounted within the pocket extrusion on the door frame. Is my voice clear, sir, at this moment?
Yes, sir, it is clear.
Thank you very
yes,
much.
Sir. Yes, sir.
So let me explain it now that there yes, is a clear. Knife. Okay, thank you very much. Let me explain that there is a knife structure on the leaf of a door. That knife structure will rest on the two RF gaskets which are mounted on the panel. These gaskets are beryllium copper finger gaskets. Beryllium copper is a very flexible material and having a high durability. When the knife edge goes in between the two gaskets, the two gaskets that will be expanding and all the leakage points will be closed by these copper finger. That will be making a perfect conductive surface, hence a better shielding effectiveness of the door. Shielding room is only effective when the RF door is manufactured to provide attenuation characteristics equal to that of the enclosure and are mechanically and aesthetically pleasing. I mean here is, if a chamber is having a shielding effectiveness of 8 dB, say at 18 gigahertz, then the door should also have shielding effectiveness of same numbers at that frequency. So door is a very, very important element of shielded chamber. It should have a very good shielding effectiveness. It should be mechanically done. Only mechanically you can make a very good shielding effectiveness. Now here you can see the door. This is a door. You can see here, this is a knife structure which is mounted on the leaf here. A knife type structure will be there, and on the panel, on this panel, we will have a beryllium fingers, one from this side, one from this side. These are the two beryllium fingers, and this knife edge will come and rest in between these two beryllium fingers. These beryllium copper fingers are highly flexible and durable, so it will hold the knife edge strongly and will perform a very good conductive surface. Power line filters. We have to bring power line inside the anechoic chamber for illuminating the lights and other requirement. We cannot directly bring power line cables inside the chamber. Why? Because power line filter will act as an antenna and will bring the outside noises inside the chamber. Hence, we are filtering the noise by using the power line filters. These power line filters are mounted on the shielded wall, and it should be near to the grounding structure, grounding of the anechoic chamber. What we need to know about power line filters, we should know the requirement of voltages, requirement of ampere, requirement of frequency like 50 hertz or 60 hertz or 400 hertz, and the phase, whether it is a single phase or three phase. Because there are various machinery sometimes which are kept inside the anechoic chamber, especially for defense application, military application, and maybe for other application also. So various power lines are to be taken inside the chamber. In addition to the power line, there is a telephone line filter. Sometime we are working in a very big anechoic chamber. That time we will need to communicate between control room and the person who is working on duty. In that situation, telephones are also used. So telephone line filters are also very important, will function on the same way. Honeycomb vents for AC. It is a honeycomb structured vent which are placed on the inlet and outlet of air conditioning system, and it is designed as per the cutoff frequency. Why we need it? Why we need, first of all, let me tell you why we need air conditioner in the chamber. Lot many of customers are asking, we don't want air conditioner, that is fine for us. Why my chamber needs air conditioner? We should know that even a small amount of RF, when it is penetrating on the surface inside the anechoic chamber, which is RF absorber, then enormous amount of heat is generated. Its RMS value is very high. This generated heat on the surface may convert into a fire. Hence, air conditioners are mandatory nowadays, especially in our country. The temperature inside the chamber should be around 22 plus minus 3 degrees centigrade. If we have our chamber which is located in this temperature range, it is fine. We don't need air conditioner. But when it is away from this range, we need air conditioner to avoid any fire. We have seen few cases of fire in our country due to various reasons. At one place, as per my experience, the fire was due to non-availability of air conditioner. Other important accessory of anechoic chamber is access panel, which is cable entry. So we have to take inside the RF cable, which should be connected with the receiving end as well as the transmitting end. We will have other cables also for antenna positioners. How we will carry it? If we carry directly inside the chamber, again, that will be a shielding problem. So what we do, we have our input-output connectors on access panel. The size of this access panel is to be decided on the basis of number of cables you want to take inside the chamber. These are connectors like BNC to BNC input-output connector, SM to SM input-output connectors, N to N input-output connectors, for 40 gigahertz, for 110 gigahertz input-output connectors. These are mounted here. what will happen? We have a coaxial cable. The skin will be connected to this connector, and again it will be grounded. So outside signal is not going inside. Same way will happen, because these RF cables are basically also shielded cables. But again, we have to remove the noise. Sometime for higher attenuation, for higher shielding effectiveness, these are the filtered connectors, where we need 100 dB type of thing. Then we are using filtered input-output connectors. This is pipe penetration. Pipe penetration is also designed as per the cutoff frequency. That is the higher side of cutoff frequency. Because at higher side, lambda is very small. Hence, it is decided designed on the basis of frequency. So one can take any cable or whatever he wants to take in. But again, that is to be care has to be taken. Again, it is to be filled with copper wool. We can see here some shielded accessories. This is shielded power filter, which is mounted on the GI sheets, that is on the panel of a chamber, air conditioning vents. Here we can see the barely finger gaskets on the door. It is a double knife-edged door, which is required for high shielding effectiveness, like 100 dB. That time we need double edge. So double knives are resting in and making a perfect shielding effectiveness. I have shown you the pipe penetration here. For some of the military application, when the equipments are, they are generating a large amount of heat, then they need to be cooled by using cooled air or by liquid coolant. So at that time, we cannot simply take the pipeline inside the chamber and give the cooling. They have to use pipe penetration. Pipe penetration is also having a honeycomb structured AC vent type structure here that is depending on cutoff frequency. And then material also in such a way that it is not getting corroded. Hence, we are using pipe penetration for carrying the liquid inside and gas, cool air inside the chamber if it is required for various application. This also we have used at various locations and at various adequate chambers. In academia, you won't find this, but it is required for the military application. Now, EMI RFI cable entry gland. For EMI EMC entry chamber, whenever we are carrying cables inside the chamber, then this cable should have these type of metal glands and the metal wool here, so that there is no leakage of RF. Other accessories, the CCTV camera, which is required to monitor the ongoing measurement of DUT inside the adequate chamber. See, it looks a very small thing, and a lot of customers will say we don't want CCTV camera. But please understand, it is only cost of 25,000 to 30,000 rupees. But CCTV cameras are very minimum. We need to see, we need to observe what is going inside the adequate chamber. Few casualties has also occurred time back where CCTV cameras are not there and the user was not able to see what is going inside the chamber. First of all, it is for the safe purpose. Second, you know whatever command you have given, the your duty is behaving like your positional rotating like that. So it is very, very important to use CCTV camera. The EMI EMC and chamber. High quality CCTV cameras are used. Quality means emission free high end cameras are required, which should able to withstand a field strength of around 200 voltmeter. And this is a very, very costly, but it is not for an adequate chamber. Fire alarm and smoke detectors also very, very important to install a chamber. Fire suppression system like as the system etc. are also important accessories for which we have to have. These are not costly items, but these are advisable ways to have a better safety of our chamber. So shielding part is what we are moving to RF absorbers and the property of reflectivity milestone of our RF chamber. The inner appearance of the radio frequency.
Sir, I want to. Sir, I think at your side the bandwidth is, sir, at your side I think the bandwidth is low. So either you can switch off the camera so that the voice could be clear.
Okay, so let me try because I'm not able to see my camera even. So how to do that? Alt tab.
On the screen.
Sir, the problem is I'm not able to see my camera or anything on the screen.
Sir, from where? From the Google Meet screen itself only where? Where you have unmuted, just beside that.
But now that has gone.
Yes, sir, it's now closed.
Now is my voice is also fine?
Sir, full screen, it's not full screen.
Is it fine, sir?
No, sir.
Can't you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see, but it's yeah, now it's full screen, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, no, sir, you can hear you.
I found. Sir, how is my voice?
Yeah, now it's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, now so it's now fine, sir.
Thank you very much. And now I move to and the internal of literacy edition called as RAM. So inside our anechoic chamber, we might have seen, all must have seen, that there are pyramidal structure RF absorbers are there. Sanjeev sir, is it okay?
Sir, in between it was breaking, but at the last it's okay.
I'll use a special.
Now it's okay. Now it's okay.
Okay, so I will slow down. What? Let me tell RAM designed to absorb incident RF radiation as effectively as possible from as many incident directions as possible. Because we will be having from outside of the chamber. To absorb the RAM in shape shall absorb effectively from the, all the direction. The more effective the RAM is, the less will be the level of lifted RF activity. We have so much activity and RF series used in the provides
the voice not clear.
You miss that? Sorry,
So I think the network problem is there at your side.
Okay.
Yeah, now it's clear.
Can you tell me? You are on my screen.
So if it's breaking, so voice is breaking. So little bit got, but again it's break. No, sir, not getting. हेलो हाँ सर ठीक 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 है और समझ गया तो तुम हाँ वो आज बारिश हो गई ना इसलिए नेटवर्क आपके यहाँ हो गया थोड़ा सा चलो कोई नहीं सर हो जाएगा तो हाँ नहीं नहीं सर बहुत अच्छा कोई दिक्कत नहीं बहुत अच्छा चल रहा था लोग ईगरली मीन्स आज बहुत अच्छी ऑडियंस हो रखी है नियर अबाउट 200 उसमें यूट्यूब पे जुड़े हैं और 100 यहाँ पे 300 लोग 300 और मैसेज कर रहे हैं सर बहुत अच्छा सेशन चल रहा है कुछ करिए आप मेरे पास मैसेज कंटिन्यूसली आ रहे हैं Yeah, sir is just connecting with another network. He will be just coming in within a minute.
mic. Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. PPT कहाँ पर है?
PPT वहाँ पर प्रेजेंट कर.
ये आ गया है. मेरी स्लाइड आपको दिख रही है क्या?
नो सर, अभी तो नहीं. वापस प्रेजेंट करिए सर वहाँ पे, जैसे आप पहले प्रेजेंट कर रहे थे.
अभी आ रहा है क्या?
नहीं सर, कुछ भी नहीं आ रहा स्क्रीन पे अभी. यू हैव टू प्रेजेंट इट.
फिर कैसे होगा?
फिर वहाँ पे गूगल में भी जाएंगे.
गूगल में जाओ ना.
गूगल में जाओ. ओके, गूगल में गया. आप भी देखे हो. प्रेजेंट नाउ विंडो जाऊँ?
हाँ, वो प्रेजेंट नाउ पे जहाँ पे सर, वो प्रेजेंट नाउ पे आप जैसे आपने पहले किया था.
आ गया?
नहीं सर, अभी नहीं आया. हाँ आ रहा है सर, आ रहा है. कमिंग.
आ गया सर? आ गया
अभी? आ रहा है सर. वो एक दो कुछ इस प्रेजेंटिंग आ रहा है, लेकिन अभी ब्लैक स्क्रीन है. यस सर, आ गई. क्लियर आ गई.
आ गई ना आपकी आवाज? तो मुझे बहुत अच्छी सुनाई दे रही है.
बिल्कुल क्लियर आ गई सर. अब इस बार की बैंडविड्थ आपकी बेटर है पहले से.
ओके सर, चार्ज. ठीक है सर, थैंक यू. तो ये फोन से मैं ऑफ, फोन तो ऑफ हो गया ना. हाँ ठीक है.
सर आप इसका कैमरा भी ऑफ कर दो, क्योंकि आपकी फिर से वो वॉइस ब्रेक होने लग गई थी.
कैमरा ऑफ कैसे कैसे करें यार?
सर वापस उसी में आपको जाना पड़ेगा, गूगल मीट में.
एक मिनट.
जहाँ से आपने वॉइस ओपन की थी ना
सर, मेरा कैमरा तो स्पीकर
माइक के बगल में.
कैमरा कैसे ऑफ करूं यार? यहाँ पर है, ये नीचे आ ही नहीं रहा इसमें.
कोई बात नहीं सर, अभी तो वॉइस क्लियर आ रही है. जब आएगी, जब प्रॉब्लम होगी तो देख लेंगे. अभी तो आप फिर कंटिन्यू कर लीजिए.
नहीं सर, एक मिनट रुकिए. मैं जाऊंगा कैमरा ऑफ करने के लिए. कहाँ जाऊं?
सर जहाँ से आपने माइक ओपन किया था ना, उसी के जस्ट बगल में कैमरा बना हुआ है.
वो ना नीचे आ नहीं रहा अभी, जहाँ से किया था.
सर माउस ऊपर नीचे करेंगे ना, वो आ जाएगा.
वही नहीं आ रहा.
संजीव सर को बोलो स्क्रीन पर रखेंगे तो भी आ जाएगा.
हाँ स्क्रीन पे सर, स्क्रीन पे आप रखेंगे ना, माउस को ऊपर नीचे करेंगे तो आ जाएगा.
सर मैं वही कर रहा हूँ.
अच्छा,
वही नहीं आ रहा है. हाँ जो आप बता रहे हैं वही नहीं हो रहा.
कोई बात नहीं सर, हो सकता है तो आप तो कंटिन्यू कर लीजिए.
फिर दिक्कत करेगा ना. रोटेशन. ओके कंटिन्यू करता हूँ.
ओके ओके सर, फुल स्क्रीन कर लीजिए.
ओके
यस सर, नाउ इट्स फुल स्क्रीन.
थैंक यू. शैल आई स्टार्ट नाउ?
या सर, श्योर.
थैंक यू. सो आई वाज thank you for the patient everybody. So there's a breakage in the connectivity. Let me start again, and I was there at reflectivity. So I think this, okay, so let us take an example. RF absorbing material used in a chamber provide reflection coefficient better than 40 dB. What does it mean? It means that it is an EM wave incident normally to surface RAM, that is radar absorbent material, the reflected wave would be 40 dB smaller. Whatever power was incident on the RF absorber, that got reduced by minus 40 dB. We call it as reflectivity of RF absorber. Here in this case, it is minus 40 dB at that particular frequency, single frequency. We have to test reflectivity of RF absorber at various different frequencies. Reflectivity, height versus frequency. We can see the height of absorber can be checked here, which is increasing from 2 to 12 to 24 to 36. And this side, it is frequency, which is again increasing. Let us take an example of this height, JVM F12, 12 inch high absorber. So what will happen at 400 megahertz, the reflectivity is minus 26 dB, at 3 gigahertz is minus 40, at 8 gigahertz minus 50, and so on. It will be increasing order, but we have taken lowest here. Let us take an example of 36 inch absorber, which will be, let us say it is better from 200 megahertz. At 200 megahertz minus 26 dB, at 400 megahertz minus 50, and then it will be increasing. So as the frequency is increasing, the reflectivity of absorber also increases. As the height is increasing, the reflectivity of absorber is increasing. I missed few slides, I think. Okay, so let me tell you, okay, so after that, how it has happened and why it is happened. Bundle RAM is at its most absorptive when the incident wave is at normal incident to the internal chamber surface, and pyramid height is approximately equal to lambda by 4, where lambda is the free space wavelength. Accordingly, increase the pyramidal height of RAM for the same base size improves the effectiveness of the chamber at low frequency. Reflectivity of absorbers increases with the increase in the frequency as wavelength gets reduced. So when the lambda is high, when frequency is low, is high, lambda, frequency high, lambda is low, frequency is low, lambda is low. So when lambda is decreasing, that means absorption is increasing. The level of absorption will go down when the wavelength is increasing. The lowest frequency of operation at which the measured reflection from the internal surfaces will be the most significant compared to high frequencies. It means that whenever we are designing the anechoic chamber, whenever we are planning for the anechoic chamber, we have to check for the lowest frequency of operation, because lowest frequency of absorber will be designed for the lowest frequency of operation, as the height will be dependent on the frequency. When RF absorber is working good at low frequency, it will be automatically working very good for high. This slide also tells frequency. The height of the absorber minus its lowest frequency of operation. At lower frequencies, the wavelength is larger. Therefore, a larger high absorber must be used for the chamber operational from low frequencies, say in megahertz. Absorbers that perform well at low frequencies automatically perform well at high frequency itself. So this a pictogram has been given just an indication. Suppose your chamber starts working for the lower frequency of megahertz, you need to use bigger absorber. Suppose you want to use to make a tera gigahertz or W band anechoic chamber, leave these big absorbers, go for small, depending upon the reflective property. And this is the meter. Let me go back again. There was a change slide. Okay. So again, we'll come back here. So at low frequency, you can see the reflectivity is less for this high absorber, and when we are going towards high, the reflectivity is increasing. Suppose you want to make any anechoic chamber for starting from 200 megahertz. Can you use the absorbers? If there are no results, no. We cannot use absorbers up to 24 inches. At 200 megahertz, we need to go for the absorber which is higher than 28 inches. This is the design factor, and the design in mining and different height of a chip. We must be very, very sure about the frequency and the absorbers. We cannot use small absorbers for low frequency and that is the cutoff frequency, low frequency is absorber size, absorber height. There are three types of RF absorbers. That means the way reporting is panic chamber. Sanjeev sir, my voice clear?
Yes sir.
Thank you. I'm checking in how you're hearing my voice. So, the first one is PU foam based absorbers. In our table, we can see that it is starting better from 200 and to any energy. So PU foam based absorbers are used from company band. See, we can make and use absorber at more energy also, but again we have to increase the height of RF absorber. That means a height of 75 inches, 75 inches are really good for 80 megahertz onwards. But at that time, the longevity of this absorber geometry is in doubt. And again, the height and size of the chamber will be very, very big and the cost is very high. So what to do? In the lower frequency, we are using ferrite tiles absorbers. Normally, these ferrite tile absorbers are used in EMI EMC chambers. These ferrite tiles are working very good from 30 megahertz, but it has a limitation of high frequency, that is 1 gigahertz. Reflectivity of ferrite tiles are also less. It is around maximum one is minus 20 dB. So we can use this absorber at low frequency. Like in EMI EMC chamber, but these chambers are starting from kilohertz and megahertz onwards. From 30 megahertz onward frequencies, for various tests, we would need RF absorbers. In that situation, what we'll be doing, we will be making hybrid of these two absorbers known as hybrid absorbers, which will be starting from 30 megahertz and above. How it will look like this? These are ferrite tiles. These are foam absorbers. Various sizes of foam absorbers, and these are joined together and it can be made like this. Ferrite tile will be placed at the bottom and the foam absorber will place over it. How it has to be done? We should take care that the impedance should match. The impedance of this foam absorber should match with the impedance of ferrite tile. Then only you can paste it. One cannot paste different type of absorbers without impedance matching. This is only the term and condition. In addition to the pyramidal shaped RF absorbers, we are using wedge shaped RF absorbers also. You can see an example of RF absorbers which are wedge shaped and housed inside the chamber. This is for the application of, in addition to antenna radiation pattern, in addition to the antenna, suppose if user want to go for the RCS measurement, then at that time, wedge-shaped absorbers are used. Why wedge-shaped absorbers are used? Because, and these RF absorbers, which is of wedge shape, will be placed in the most speculative zone of an anechoic chamber. So when it is placed on the most speculative zone of anechoic chamber, what will happen? It will, the RF reflected wave will get a direction. It will be directed in one direction and will be absorbed easily. It will not be reflected in various directions. Hence, we are using wedge-shaped absorber for RCS special application. One is RCS measurement. In anechoic chamber, other type of absorber we have to plan is a walk-on anechoic chamber, RF absorbers. This is a solid structure. You can see here how these walk-on absorber are placed inside the chamber. What we have to do? We cannot walk on these foam absorbers. So we have to walk on these solid foam, solid walk-on absorber. How these are made? Inside this solid box, outside there's a low dielectric material, and inside there's a RF absorber having the same reflectivity of these neighborhood absorbers. Well, after we understood about reflectivity and shielding effectiveness, let us go to the measurement techniques of these two properties. So how we are testing the RF absorbers? IEEE 1128 has clearly stated the measurement system for how it is to be measured. What we have, what we'll do, I'll be explaining in this photograph. This is an anechoic chamber. Complete RF anechoic chamber is there. Inside there is an ARC. NRL stands for Naval Research Laboratory of America. So this arch is housing two antennas. One is transmitting, one is receiving. Here it is a metallic plate. Metallic plate height can be varied, and in this way we are varying the far field distance. This metal plate is in the far field, that is 2d square by lambda, and this complete length from transmitter to the plate and to the transmitting antenna is 2d square by lambda, that is a far field. What we will be doing, we'll be having RF source, we'll be having RF receiver. First, we measure the power received by the receiver of metal plate, and afterward, we are putting the RF absorber. We will be measuring the power. We will certainly find that the RF power has gone down. The difference between the initial reference, we call as a reference power, and the received power, this difference is reflectivity, what we have studied. Again, these antenna will be moving from this place to this place, this place to this place, and checking the reflectivity from various incident angles. This way, we are testing our RF absorbers at our premises. And this is the only standard method of testing pyramidal shape or any absorber which are placed inside the nuclear chamber or used anywhere in NRL arch method as per IEEE 1128. It's a standard method. This one is an anechoic chamber having two horn antennas of low frequency from 500 megahertz onwards. And we are testing here the RF absorber at lower frequency. You can see here, this is a metallic arch, which is completely like this, and it's a complete anechoic chamber. See, I will be focusing on very different property of RF absorber other than the RF property, which is called as fire retardancy. Nowadays, this property is a very, very important. Most of the manufacturers, they are concentrating on the reflectivity, that is the RF property of RF absorber. What will happen if it is non-fire retardant? When we are adding fire retardant chemical, then at that time, the reflectivity, the performance of RF absorbers goes down. So we have to be very, very careful. So maybe the manufacturer may be avoiding this, but one should not avoid. There are three standard tests for testing the fire retardancy of RF absorber. Fire retardancy means if an absorber catches a fire, that time the absorber should get extinguished by itself. It should not expand the fire. This is what the fire retardancy meaning, and it is again, it was approved, it was done by Naval Research Laboratory of USA, and the standard is NRL 8093. It is used worldwide. There are various fire retardant standards, UL standards, DIN standards, but those are only for the building material, for the construction material. For RF absorbers, the most important one is NRL 8093. We should be very, very careful in buying our absorbers. And the test report, if somebody wants to check the property, should and buying a bigger anechoic chamber, buying a costlier RF absorber, one should go and check the premises of a manufacturer for these tests. Reflectivity as well as fire retardancy. There are three tests. One is, number one is resistance to electrical stress, ease of ignition and flame propagation, and third is a smoldering test. Sometime being an RF engineer, we will be feeling bored about these three names, about this RF fire retardancy. But please make sure that this is very important property of RF absorber you are buying. You will be very happy to buy a very good RF absorber having very good reflectivity, but make sure it should always be a very good fire retardant. As I told you, if a small amount of RF is penetrating at a particular smaller portion of absorber inside the anechoic chamber, an enormous amount of heat is generated and it can cause a big fire. So the test of electrical stress, there's a small block, we insert naked wire into it, and as this block of absorber, we know that it becomes conductive, so this will get a spark, the short circuit, and a fire will be generated. When fire is generated, it should get extinguished within time frame of 30 seconds or 1 minute as per the standard, which is clearly written. If it is like that, then the fire, your absorber sample is passed. Second, there's a Bunsen burner for testing of ease of ignition and flame propagation. This burner is placed below a 2-inch cube, 2-inch very small cube RF absorber. When you put a normal foam into it, this normal foam will get melted in few seconds. But when we put RF absorber, this absorber will catch fire. Then we have to remove the Bunsen burner after 30 seconds. After removing the burner as specified in the standard, this RF absorber sample should get extinguished by itself within time frame of 1 minute. Again, very important. Number three is a smoldering test. What is smoldering test? This is a block of 8-inch cube inserted with a heater. Heater will also have a thermocouple joined with it and a different thermocouple. What will happen? This is a control panel having temperature, time display, and switches. First, this heater will be heated up to 600 degrees centigrade. Up to 600 degrees centigrade, for 5 minutes, it should retain the same heat of 600 degrees centigrade. That means a continuous supply of heat should be there. If it is coming down, it will come up. Like that, this automatic PLC system has been made. 600 degree temperature will remain for 5 minutes, and this thermocouple which is attached to it will be showing that temperature. After 5 minutes, the supply will be switched off. What will happen? The another thermocouple, which is 1 inch apart, will measure the temperature. And it will see initially what will happen. As the supply is off, the temperature goes down slowly, which can be monitored by using this thermocouple in the screen. But after some time, the temperature will start rising. We have to see that. Anytime, as per standard, the temperature should not go above 450 degrees centigrade. If a temperature goes about 450 centigrade, that means the fire which was residing inside the block now is coming up and the sample will burn. That is the failure portion of the sample. Very, very interesting for our chamber designers and planners who has to make. Now, other very important thing for planning the anechoic chamber is the dimension. Everybody is asking, how big chamber we have to make? What should be the length of my chamber? Is 3 meter fine? Is 6 meter fine? Is 7 meter fine? So it is a basic question. And after getting approval of fund and everything, we start calculating on the dimension of anechoic chamber. So I will be explaining here how you have to calculate the length and dimension of RF anechoic chamber. It will be for far field anechoic chamber, because most of our researcher in academia, they are working in far field anechoic chambers only. So we'll be working on that, because compact antenna test ranges and near field antenna test ranges are very, very costly. But this presentation is most focused on the far field anechoic chambers. Now, for calculating the far field, we have calculated the far field distance. Now, stand in designing the chamber, here D is the maximum dimension of your antenna under test or the device under test. That the D is that. It is not the standard horn gain antenna or other gain antenna what you will be using for testing the your anti-inunder test. It is the dimension, maximum dimension of anti-inunder test or device under test. Far field distance is to be calculated for lowest and the highest frequency of any echo chamber. Lowest is very important because at low frequency, dimension of antenna is big. At high frequency, dimension of antenna is small. So the bigger dimension will come and the far field distance will be more at lower frequencies. Why higher frequencies? Because you have to take care of your antenna, what type of antenna you will have, whether you are making a single patch, whether you will be making an array of an antenna. So that antenna will form the array antenna will be having a bigger dimension. So D is that, and that must be calculated at high frequency, because that distance is also very important. At the far field distance should match with the distance of your D. Mostly it will be less, but sometime it can become more when you are testing array. Air distance between RX antenna and chamber wall. See, in addition to the far field distance, you need to add distance between receive antenna and the chamber wall. Again, you need to add distance between TX sidewall, positioner thickness, and length of TX antenna. I'll show you another slide, but for a reference purpose, example, the far field plus far field distance for an echo chamber, which are mostly used in India for academia, will be having another more 8.5 feet distance in case of absorber height of 1 feet. When you are using absorber on the both the side wall of 1 feet, then you need to add 8.5 feet. How? I'll show you here. You just see, this is that 8.5 will come in another slide. First, let us understand, this is a transmitting antenna. These are absorbers on the transmitting side. Because we have fund constraint and dimension constraint, what we have done in this case in a few engineering colleges, that this transmitting antenna is mounted on the wall itself. This mounting structure is of it's not an automatic, it's a manual way we are doing. If it is an automatic also, there will be a positioner of the similar height thickness. That positioner will be placed here, and this is a testing antenna. So we have to take care of this distance, and then distance of an antenna. It is after this only the far field distance will start. So we have to add this complete distance, which is there at the transmitting end. Just see here, transmitting wall. This is our transmitting wall. This is our roll positioner, which is around say 1 to 1.5 feet of height. And then our antenna again, which is from 1 to 1.5. Let us say we have considered this as a 2.5. It's not the standard one. See, we have to see our absorber, what we are using. Approximately, I'm telling you, it is 2.5 feet. Then there's a walk-on absorber. One can stand here and work on this antenna. This is the transmitting wall. And we have taken 2.5 feet. Now, here we are at the receiver side. What will happen at the receiver side? The geometry is little different. We have RF absorber here, and we will be putting one more RF absorber, which is of 2 feet. I have taken RF absorber of height 1 feet, 1 feet plus 2 feet, it is 3 feet. Then there will be a walk-on absorber, which is around 2 feet of dimension. And again, this is a positioner. We have taken it as 2 feet, and up to center, it is 1 feet. So now, add this distance into far field, 1 plus 2, 3 plus 2, 5 and 6. 6 feet plus 2.5, we have seen at the transmitting end, it has become 8.5 feet. It is an approximate distance. You have to increase the far field plus 8.5 feet for the lowest frequency of operation, for the lowest dimension of lowest frequency, the D of your antenna under test. If we know now the dimension of our chamber, now let us come to the very important property to be tested inside the chamber. Now we learned about the shielding, but we have not seen how it is to be tested. We learned about the shield reflectivity. Now we know how reflectivity of absorber are tested. Now first we are learning the quiet zone. Quiet zone of an NEK chamber is a defined volume within the chamber where a device under test is to be placed for evaluation. It's a defined volume. Quiet zone probing is accomplished by moving a probe. We would need a quiet zone probe for testing the quiet zone. The quiet zone probe should move in all the direction inside the quiet zone region. Quiet zone can be a cube, can be a cuboid, can be a cylinder. So in that zone, we have to move our quiet zone probe and check the level of received signal. So hence, quiet zone probing is accomplished by moving a probe antenna through the quiet zone to determine the level of extraneous signals entering the volume. Quiet zone probing most often uses multiple access probe. So we should have multiple access probe to see the dimension, to see the receiving of RF power from the various angles, various sides inside the NEK chamber. The probe is moved along the line of planes within the quiet zone volume. Each scan provides amplitude and phase versus linear position data, which is sufficient to characterize the level of extraneous signals in the quiet zone at the position of scan. Angle of arrival of the extraneous signals can also be determined. This technique can adequately characterize electromagnetic field purity within the quiet zone. How it will be done, I'll tell you. First, see one example of our NEK chamber. It is a compact view of measurement set of 110 gigahertz NEK chamber. This we have done for 1D audio lab. You can see here, this is a manual antenna positioner. It is three rotating axis plus three axis down, like left and right, front and back, up and down, plus three axis here. This is a TX antenna, on antenna of W band. And here how it looks. You can see here walk on absorber all around with different angles. This is one case of NEK chamber. I want to show you different applications of NEK chamber, and afterward I'll be explaining the quiet zone and shielding also. Now this chamber is for Bharat Electronics Limited. It is a 250 megahertz to 40 gigahertz. This facility is very big. They have the absorbers are 3 feet high, looking very small in this case. This is a transmitting end side having a walk on in between, and this side is a door. Just see another RF NEK chamber. This RF NEK chamber is for RCS measurement. This we have given to DRDO lab, and we can see here that it has a wedge shape absorber, and the sample is kept here, which is scaled down in the sense as a sphere. So they'll be taking their RCS of the material with respect to this sphere. The pylon is of a low dielectric material, that is the styrofoam. Beneath that, there is an antenna positioner. This antenna positioner is a two-axis antenna positioner, that is azimuth and elevation. This side, other side of the chamber, we have a measurement technique for the biostatic RCS. Two antennas are placed in an arc type of situation for the measurement of RCS. Now, you can see here a different application of NEK chamber. In this NEK chamber, it is for the MiG-29 aircraft as well as for the MiG-21 aircraft. What will happen? This chamber is divided into two portions. One portion is this. Behind this, you can see one room here, and this is a cutout being made. That is a wall has come in between a big NEK chamber. This room is a control room that is also made anechoic, and the radar trolley being brought here. Radar trolley, after bringing in this room, the radar cone, that is an antenna portion, will come out here, and the testing of this radar properties will be done inside this chamber. These are the walk-on absorbers, and we can see various geometry of RF absorbers. That is for the radar testing of fighter aircrafts, which we have given to Indian Air Force. See here, it's an amazing NEK chamber. It is a 55 meter long NEK chamber, that is for Su-30 aircraft. What happens? This is a crane which will pull the aircraft in. The aircraft will rest here. All these sides are RF absorbers. It's a very old chamber, so the absorber is of original color, black. Right? The nose cone of aircraft will go inside this. This is a conductive fabric, so making this chamber 100 dB shielding effectiveness. It's a very unique, so big chamber have a shielding effectiveness of very high level, that is 100 dB. Nose cone will enter inside this, and inside this there is a complete anechoic chamber, the similar way I have shown you here. Inside this, like this is a complete anechoic chamber, similar fashion when Sukhoi nose cone comes in that chamber, which is completely anechoic, and then various parameters of the chamber are being tested. This facility is there with Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. This facility we have supplied when I was part of Lambda Microwave Technology. So testing of anechoic chamber, I come back again after showing you few cases of anechoic chambers, so you understand like what are the applications and things, different various types of anechoic chamber. Now we'll be testing the quiet zone of anechoic chamber. We have already tested the reflectivity of RF absorber. This quiet zone is to be tested as per free space VSWR method. What will happen? How we do that? First, we are, our receiving antenna and transmitting antenna are facing each other. We will be detecting the best power, that is the line of sight, and we will be recording it as a reference signal. Afterward, one of our antenna, with the help of quiet zone probe, the antenna will move to the direct towards the sidewall, and it will be receiving the signal. So what we will be doing here, we will be measuring the ripples magnitude here, peak to where there will be a peak in this ripple, one maxima and minima. Wherever we have a maxima and a sudden drop in the signal, the minima will be created, that two signal will be recording. This is the combined signal VSWR pattern, right? So this is our setup for quiet zone testing. We have RF source, we have transmitting antenna, we have receiving antenna, we have quiet zone probe, and then we have source. It will be transmitting, it will be receiving. This guy is kept inside the quiet zone area, which we have calculated on the basis of far field. And again, we have set up the method I've shown here. The process also, I've told you that side, that we'll be taking the minima and maxima, and then from the various different angles, the frequency will be one, there will be a particular frequency, there will be a particular direction, say 60 degree right side, then we'll be receiving the signal, and then we'll be creating, we'll be finding the VSWR method and the reflectivity of anechoic chamber. This wave signal has been received when we are moving in the quiet zone area, that is, this one is a zero, and it has gone up to 70 centimeter. That means one side is 70 centimeter. It is the center location of the antenna, the center point of a quiet zone, which has the probe has gone centimeter toward this side, as we will be doing for this side also. We do, but if we do not do even, but the as it is a symmetrical, we can consider the same for other side, but normally we'll be doing for both the sides. These are the power signal power levels received in that quiet zone area. We'll be determining the maxima and minima, and by putting the form in the formula of impedance and VSWR, we will be getting the reflectivity. We will be the addition of VSWR at pattern level. The formula is given here, you can note down, and hence this is the way we will be calculating the quiet zone level of RF anechoic chamber. Hope you understood that. Now the other property of RF anechoic chamber is the shielding effectiveness. Sanjeev sir, hope you are hearing me.
Kala sir, I am also hearing you. Doctor SK Jain.
You can,
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Thank you. Great. Thank you very much, sir. Now, shall I proceed now? Because I was checking like whether my voice is there or not. Because I can't see my photo also, and I cannot see anything other than my screen. Thank you very much. So now we are going to the shielding effectiveness test procedure. This shielding effectiveness test is again standardized and written in IEEE 299. Earlier it was male standard 285, but now it is IEEE 299. That male standard 285, most of the places it is obsolete, but some are using, but the new one is IEEE 299, which is more stringent technique. So I'll be explaining you in this block diagram. We have RF source, same, we have a antenna, transmitting antenna, we have receiving antenna, we have antenna stand, and we have a source, spectrum analyzer. What we will be doing, shielding, as we know, it is an isolation between the outside the chamber and inside of an equipped chamber. First, we will measure the direct signal, the signal what we are receiving in the open air. That will be done near by the side of the anechoic chamber. We'll note down that. That's, that reference level will be the reference signal. Let us say, we have to measure the shielding effectiveness at the door. What we'll do, we will take our receiving setup inside the anechoic chamber, we will keep our transmitting setup outside the anechoic chamber, and in the door opening condition, we will measure the received signal. What is the power we are receiving in the line of sight without any isolation? Afterward, we will close the door and see the level of RF signal which has gone down. The difference of these two signals is the shielding effectiveness. Shielding effectiveness is to be measured in all the places which are accessible. For example, the door, the access panel, the power line filter. Wherever it is accessible, at that point we have to test. I mean, I'm telling you accessible, why? Because there are components. There's a situation where we cannot access to those components because they are put on very high height, or in the place where we don't have place to go because of the constraint of our lab dimension. This is how we are recording the shielding effectiveness test results. We have to note it will be done for the various frequencies. Normally, frequency will be selected from the band of frequency, like S band, L band, C band, X band. We'll be testing one. We'll be using one frequency as per the choice of our user. User has to tell, because I'll be testing my device at that frequency. That frequency can be used as a test point. We will be putting down the reference level first, as I told you, direct signal, which of low side, then measured signal of blocking, that means after putting the shield, and the difference is the shielding effectiveness. This effectiveness is already defined in the requirement. Suppose we have to go for 70 dB shielding effectiveness requirement, our shielding effectiveness should be more than or equal to that 70 dB. This is how we are doing the shielding effectiveness test of an anechoic chamber. So we have learned testing of RF absorber, testing of reflectivity inside the chamber, testing of shielding effectiveness of the anechoic chamber. These are very important properties one should understand, one should design, and how we test that. Now, when our anechoic chamber is ready, we have to have a software results of the antenna what we have manufactured, what we have designed and developed. We should have antenna positioner. These antenna positioners normally used in modern time are three-axis antenna positioners. This antenna positioner is having azimuth rotation as well as the elevation rotation. It will be kept at the side of device under test. Device under test will be mounted on this. We will be fixing this antenna positioner to a certain height where it reaches to the center of quiet zone. In front of that, there will be a roll positioner which will be mounted on the transmitting side. So we have three-axis automatic antenna positioner, two-axis this side and one here for changing the polarization. We have third axis. Again, we have two different types of controller. We can make other type also. One is to be fixed on the 19 inches rack, 19 RU rack. If you have, then use this. And this one is for the tabletop. Another type of positioner is this. This guy is also two axis. It's a having a plastic body for low weight requirement. And these are for heavy weight requirement. Then there's a software. This software should support different manufacturers' please, yes, sir, please, measurement please, instruments.
Please, yes, please.
So when we have selected and so we have manufactured.
Okay, sir, continue now.
Thank you, sir. Now when we are ready with the antenna positioner, we should have software. And that software should be like that. It should be compatible with any VNA, any signal generator, any spectrum analyzer of any manufacturer, Agilent, Anrisu, R&S, or whatever you have. That software should able to give 3D spherical plot, basic 3D plots, reference antenna import feature, multiple S parameters, multiple traces plots, all the properties of antenna you should able to measure, and any other thing, especially the RCS also. This one for antenna and the other properties, other tests, whatever is required for different specific application that software can provide. So that is about the software requirement and antenna positional requirement. At the end, now when we understood about the Anechoic chamber, then we have to plan our requirement of Anechoic chamber. This is a small type of a questionnaire. It will summarize each and everything, whatever we have discussed in our slides. This we have to write down and learn ourselves, and then we should make ourselves ready what we need. First, we have to write down the length and width and height of any kit chamber. Length we know from the experience what we have discussed earlier. Now, what will be the width and height? Height and width should be similar. That should be, the length should be 2 to 3 times of height and width. The best one is 3 times, but 2 to 3 times is also fine. Suppose you have a height and width of say a 3 meter or 4 meter, which is approximately similar, then your chamber size should be between 6 to 9 meter. This is the relevant symmetric of our Anechoic chamber. Again, it is just a thought. We have to calculate this with the help of our distance calculator, like our far field distance behind the antenna of both the sides. Then we should write what is the purpose of our chamber. Is it an antenna testing? Is it a shield, a EMI EMC chamber? Is it for any other purpose? There are various applications you can do by using any chamber. That purpose is to be shared. What will be the shielding effectiveness requirement? Whether we are happy with 50 dB or we require 80 dB or we need 100 dB. More the dBs will be inviting more cost of any chamber. After 70 or 80 dB, the chamber shielding cost gets doubled because it needs that more specific fine requirement of the shielding material. All this to be tested by using IEEE 299. Now, we have to see ceiling support. What does it mean? Whether self-supporting chamber or supported by parent room. Whether we have a good space for housing our Anechoic chamber, space is large, then we can go for self-supporting. And suppose if we have a constraint of room, suppose we have only 3 meter across, 4 meter across, say 5 meter room, then we need to fix our shielded panels on the wall itself. At that time, it will be supported by parent room. This also one has to decide. And in that situation, when it is poor, when it is fixed at the on the walls, on the roof or floor of the existing building, that time, sometime it becomes tedious or difficult to make a panel Anechoic chamber. Number of doors, how many doors we need? Suppose our device is a smaller, chamber is smaller, and that time we would need the standard door of 3 feet by 7 feet. Suppose our device under test is 2 meter and 1.5 meter, more than 3 feet, that time we would need a customized door. We have to think about the size of door also, what should be the door size. any other size, write down. You have a bigger chamber room, go for two doors. One door will be placed at the transmitting side, one door will be placed on the receiving side, so that you are not wasting time in going inside the chamber and destroying the symmetry of it. More you go inside, more you are using it, more we are creating the aging factor. Then again, input and output connectors. How many input output connectors? What connectors we have? How many BNC cable we have to take in? How many end-to-end cable? How many SMA to SMA? How many higher frequencies 2.92? How many for W band? Whatever band we are using. So we have to see which cable we are going to use. Suppose we are using a female male cable, then this input output connector should be female on the both the sides. This is also an indicative and important factor for calculating, because these things will also have cost. RF waveguide pipe penetration, how many pipe, whether you need pipe penetration or not, how many pipe penetration you want, we have to write that. The dimension will be calculated as you have already written the frequency of operation of any chamber. I missed here. We have to write the frequency of operation of any chamber, what is the lowest and what is the highest. One should not say, I want any chamber up to 40 gigahertz. We get so many inquiries, sir, I want any chamber up to 40 gigahertz. We know that lowest frequency is very important for designing and deciding the cost factor. That's why one should understand, okay, look, I want telecom antenna to be made, to be fabricated. So I want from 800 megahertz. I want antenna to be fabricated from 2 gigahertz onwards or 1 gigahertz onwards. That type one should write here. Because the lowest, now we understand that the lowest frequency is the most important for designing the anechoic chamber, for determining the cost of it. Now, RF honeycomb air vents, what is the size of honeycomb vent we need, length into width, and how many? See, in this situation, what will happen? RF honeycomb vents are required to be placed in front of air conditioning inlet and outlet. Suppose if you have centralized AC inside the building, then only you can do it. But most of the time we have seen with our users, especially when the antenna and chambers are made, this centralized AC is not there. So either we have to go for ductable AC, or when the shielding effectiveness is not very high, then to go for split AC. That time one should write that we would need air conditioner also. If you have air conditioner, write down, it will be used, split air conditioner is used, or ductable AC conditioner is used. For split air conditioner, we will be using pipe penetration. For ductable air conditioner, we will be using the honeycomb AC vents. This is the difference. One should be very, very careful about it for making the budget. Again, power line filters. Sometimes we have only one power line which is coming inside an anechoic chamber. Then we will need voltage, 220 volt or 440 volt. Ampere, how many ampere you are looking for? Whether 60 hertz or 400 hertz, whether single phase or three phase. More number of filters, more information will be required. It all depends upon the power line, electrical power line you want to take inside the anechoic chamber. As I also said, telephone line filter can also be used, but not in our academia, but for industry where they have bigger anechoic chamber, that time it is used. Otherwise, we are simply increasing the cost. Emission-free light points, how many? How many, whether you want a day-type light inside the chamber or normal lights inside the chamber? Then you go and just, if you can imagine that, like how many lux or what is the intensity of light or how many wattage you are happy, you can write down or leave it to the manufacturer, which they can decide and guide you. More shielding effective is required for the light when it is put inside the EMI EMC chamber. We have to very, very careful. EMI EMC chamber, all these accessories are to be designed in a different manner. CCTV is required, yes or no? How many cameras I want? Whether I want to see transmitting antenna side also, or I want to see the receiving antenna only, what will be the size of my anechoic chamber? Suppose anechoic chamber is less than 10 meter, then I would need only one camera, which can focus on receiver side. I would need one more camera, which can focus on transmitting side. So I'm very happy. So let us go for the two number of antenna. Fire alarm system, very simple, not cost effective. Small detectors, some better fire alarm system, VESDA system is there, that is a little bit costly. But for our academia, this normal detectors are they're fine for us. For industry, for bigger anechoic chambers, VESDA system is fine for us. Fire suppression system for bigger anechoic chamber, where more RF power is to be illuminated, that time we should need gas-based fire system. We have seen few accidents in India and all around the world. So fire suppression system nowadays is very important, but these are very costly also. One should go for normal fire cylinders when we can see, when we have CCTV, when CCTV is functioning, then it is fine. Then we know what is going on, our fire cylinders are fine for us. But in case of a bigger chamber, when you have a big, we have to test your device under test for more number of hours, maybe 24 hours, maybe 48 hours, there are military equipments which are tested continuously for 1 day or 2 days to be kept inside the chamber. There we should need a very good fire suppression system, that is the gas-based fire system. Otherwise, for normal time, fire extinguishers are very good. 6,000, 2,000 or 5,000, that should be the cost of one extinguisher. Air conditioner, as I told you, whether you want or you already have it, just think about it and share with your manufacturer. Earthing less than 2 ohm, very, very important. Must cater for this, because now we have to see it is required. And what will be the cost of that copper strip we are using it, and your earthing, maintenance free earthing. It's very simple thing, but very important for our anechoic chamber. It is one of the best accessory, I can tell you, a very good earthing of anechoic chamber. That will be only grounding your noise. Need RF absorber? Yes, for antenna chamber we would need RF absorber. What will be the height of absorber you prefer? You go to the manufacturer's data sheet, see there, you are happy with the reflectivity of which RF model, select that RF model and then give the model number. In our case, it is JVM FU. You can write height 9 inches, 12 inches, 18 inches, 24 inches here, and then we can. Data sheet you already have. What is the size of quiet zone? Very, very important. So this will be helping the manufacturer to again, whatever, to see the design, what you have given, what you have written in the questionnaire, what you have planned, it will be cross-checked with the manufacturer's development team also. Floor of the building. In which floor you will be manufacturing this anechoic chamber? Whether ground floor, first floor, second floor, third floor, no, so many floors are there nowadays. Why we need this? It is required to calculate the earthing requirement. It should be required to calculate how many feet of copper wire is required. Sometime only one earthing pit will not serve the purpose. For that, we would go for multiple number of pits, one pit, two pit, three pit. There are various factors. What is the ground condition? How much ground is resistive? Accordingly, we will be calculating the earthing requirement on the basis of your floor also, the distance between any chamber and the earth. Let me tell you, for EMI EMC chamber, you would need the EMI EMC chamber very near to the ground. Otherwise, one may not get 100 dB or 110 dB after some time. Whether you need antenna positioners, controllers, an additional PC also required, whether you have or you already have a laptop or PC in your lab, so you will need only antenna positioner and its controller, because you have a controller, but you can also control with your PC. The software will be loaded in your PC, which will be determining, which will be giving you the properties of an antenna or whatever test you want to do. So we should be very, very careful in designing the antenna positioner. Whether we have a fund, we go for the automatic, we can postpone, we can go for the manual type of a positioner. At this moment, we'll buy only an anechoic chamber and can buy a positioner later on. So that time, that also to be shared. How many axes you are looking for, then weight carrying capacity of a positioner. Positioner is designed on the weight carrying capacity, 10 kg, 20 kg, 2 kg. Some academia, they are working on heavy antennas also, and most of them are working on patch panels. In that situation, there is no problem of weight carrying capacity. And some specific projects when you guys are doing, that time weight is very, very important. What will be the diameter of top, table top? Suppose you are testing a reflector antenna, it is of bigger size, then you may look for the bigger table top, bigger top of the antenna positioner, so you can mount it very easily. So that tabletop diameter is also very important. What is an accuracy desired? What will be the accuracy? Very good accuracy, some microns are desired. You have to design, you have to write down, you have to think about it. It will be a costly affair. Even like 0.1 degree, at this moment, most of the academia, most of the institutions are having this accuracy of 0.1 degree now. Earlier, it used to be, they used to be happy with the accuracy of 1 degree, but now it has come down to 0.1. The cost has also gone down. It's not very costly to get the antenna positioner of 0.1 degree accurate results. Testing of antenna is required, yes or no, whether you need an antenna, whether you want to get the standard Hongen antenna, you have to write, yes, I need standard Hongen antenna, I don't have, from which frequency this is to be planned. So that single reach can be procured from, say, 2 to 18 gigahertz or 1 to 18 gigahertz, from 18 to 26 point other, from 36.5 to 40 gigahertz other. Like that time, can those things can be calculated. If you want only S parameters, then you don't need ridge antenna. Then you would need all the various bands of antenna, from L band, S band, C band, whatever you want to do. Your requirement changes at that time. Whether you need RF cables, yes, I need, no, I don't have, you have to think and write down what will be the size of my RF cable and how many numbers I need. Whether you have measurement instruments, whether you have VNA, whether you have signal generator or spectrum analyzer, write down here. Think whether you need it or not. If you need, you are ready with the planning. What choice you are looking for? Get quotation from Keysight, R&S and Amrisu. And then see their specification, check their specification. If you don't have, if you already have, very nice. Gentlemen and ladies, this was on the subject. I'm open for your valuable questions and suggestions. If you want, my email ID and contact details all are there with the organizers. And in my first slide also, it was mentioned, my email ID and contact details. I'm ready for the suggestions and questions.
Okay, thank you, sir. Okay, sir, they are taking from the participants. First question.
Doctor.
I have not heard the question. I'm sorry.
Why wet? You ask the question, then I will.
Sanjeev sir, I'm not hearing anything.
Okay, sir, the wire wedge shape is used in chamber.
Well, good question. I have also explained it during my presentation that wedge shaped absorbers will be giving the direction of the reflected signal. And slowly, when it is giving a direction towards a one direction, towards one wedge, that signal will be absorbed effectively. If you are using pyramidal absorber, in the requirement of, say, RCS measurement, that pyramidal absorber will be reflecting in all 360 degree. But in wedge shape, that reflection will be in one direction, and most of the signal will be absorbed effectively very shortly. That's what wedge-shaped absorbers are used.
Sir, next question is, what type of thermocouple is used?
What type of thermocouple? See, for that designer is different. I'm not the designer of a thermocouple, but which can sense the temperature up to 600 degrees C and above. That type of thermocouple is required.
Okay, so next question is, do we have any standard shape for echo chamber?
Yes, we have different standard shapes. One is the rectangular anechoic chamber that we normally we are making. One is a tapered anechoic chamber that is also there. There is a taper in the beginning, and then there will be a rectangular shape afterward. There is a different presentation on this subject. but we have a different shapes of Wernicke chambers.
So next question is, what is eco-friendly absorbers?
Eco-friendly absorbers. Well, actually what is happening when absorbers are placed inside the anechoic chamber, it is absorbing the RF signals. When it is absorbing the RF signal, the reflected signal is less. When the reflected signal is less, that means it is not creating an echo. Whenever we are speaking, say in acoustic example, I'll give you the acoustic anechoic chamber is cinema hall. They have placed lot many absorbers all around, wood, curtain, foam absorber inside it. So it is absorbing the noise. So we hear only very less noise because that noise is absorbed. Here also, in our case, absorbers are absorbing the noise, means most of the RF signal has been absorbed up to 95 degree, 99% has been absorbed. So the reflected signal will not cause any echo. So putting these absorbers inside the anechoic chamber make it a non-echo anechoic absorber.
Okay, so next question is, how to match impedance of PU foam with ferrite tiles in broadband hybrid anechoic chambers?
Well, very good. It's a topic of research. So researchers had to work on it. So that is a different topic. And sometime it's confidential for us, but I can tell you, you can use a different chemical layers to match the impedance.
Okay, sir. Next question is, absorber color is always blue or it can be changed. Any change in color of absorber, will it affect the frequency or temperature?
So, you know, everybody is very much interested to know about the color. Color is not a matter. We can put any color. You put, if you like pink color of absorbers, pink color of absorber will be there. You like orange, you like yellow, all colors of absorber can be made. It has no effect on temperature, on reflectivity or shielding, anything. It's the color has been given for the aesthetics only.
Okay, sir, next question is, for finalizing the anechoic chamber dimensions, why should we calculate the far field at the highest operating frequency in addition to the lowest operating frequency?
See, if you have calculated the lowest frequency, your work has been done. For extra precaution, for taking care of extra thing, like suppose we have a bigger size of antenna at higher frequencies. A small antenna, 40 gigahertz, a patch will be very, very smaller. But suppose somebody is doing research on array of antenna. So at that moment, because that array will be smaller for the lower frequency, but for higher frequency, it can become a bigger one. So at that time, your far field distance will increase if you are testing it. Because we can see that the increase in the frequency will reduce the size of quiet zone. Whatever quiet zone we are getting at lower frequency, say it is a 1 meter or 2 meter, same we will not get at high frequency. We may be getting 10 centimeter only at 40 gigahertz or 20 centimeter only, maybe less, depending upon the size of your anechoic chamber. That's why it's a precaution we have taken to calculate the size at high frequency also.
Okay, sir. Next question is, in some of the anechoic chambers, PU foam absorber of different sizes are seen. How efficient are those anechoic chambers at lowest usable frequency?
I missed your initial part of the question.
In some anechoic chambers, PU foam absorber of different sizes are seen. How efficient are those anechoic chambers at lowest usable frequency?
Well, who has asked this question? Can I know his name, please?
Yes, is a student? Yes. Ardhendu Kundu.
Okay. It's a really very good question he has asked. Thing is, the more speculative area of the chamber will have bigger size of absorbers. And when you are moving towards the corner, that time there is an opportunity that designer has put smaller size of absorber. In other example, smaller size of absorbers, he might have seen at the back side of the transmitting antenna, at the transmitting side. So what is the reason? In the corner, RF energy will not play a major role inside the chamber. Most of the energy has been absorbed by those bigger size of any RF absorbers. RF tip should not touch either each other, should not destroy the RF absorbers. If you are using the same type of, same height of RF absorber, then your tip will be touching and will be damaging the RF absorber. Hence, we will be using smaller size of RF absorber in the corner, in the tapered shape. Secondly, at the transmitting wall, when you have a smaller size of RF absorber, in the transmitting side, you have only a minor lobes or back lobes of the signal. So you will be having a lower power at the backside. So it has been made a smaller size. By the side of the transmitting wall, again, some manufacturers are putting smaller size because the bandwidth of an antenna, what you will be using, will not be affecting the side portion. It will be a minor side lobes only. The power is less. So that has been designed in such a way that you can put smaller absorber in the near to the back wall. Hope I could answer his question.
Yes, our next question is by Arti Srivastav. How NQX absorbers understand the manufacturing process and how this impacts absorber quality?
Manufacturing process, very important. Manufacturing RF absorbers had a process, and this process always have some time period. One should adhere to the time period. If chemical has to be mixed for some time, that has to be mixed for that time. If we reduce the time period of that, chemical mixing will not be good. If we dry absorber fast in high temperature, the life of absorber is affected. So manufacturing process, the standard manufacturing process has to be put. Making any changes in it, it will deteriorate the property of absorber for longer life. Life of absorber will be shorter.
Okay, sir. One question by Professor S. Raghavan, NIT Tirchi.
Yes.
Yeah. Why black color at the tip of the absorbers?
Dr. Raghavan, it is only for the aesthetic, for making it a beautiful, so that it looks nice inside the chamber. The black tips are there. It is only to create an aesthetic, but one should know that the black color is the only original color of an absorber. If you happen to visit our factory in the place in the manufacturing floor, you will see only black color all around. So to make it more beautiful, we put different color by the side of it. One can put complete blue. One can make it, one can remove that black shade by putting other color. It has no meaning on the technical view.
Okay. Satish Jansar is just raising his hand for asking one question.
Yes, please.
Thank you, Mahesh ji. Congratulations for wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
Okay. My question is, Mahesh ji, we are always going for far field measurement.
Yes.
Can we go for near field measurement through your chamber?
Yes. Why not? We have made already near field test ranges also, and compact antenna test ranges also by using our chamber. So designer had to give the dimension of his scanner and its probe and all the whatever he wants, like a field and everything. On the basis of the dimension of scanner, the chamber can be designed and one can do. But again, whatever chamber you have, that the chamber should accommodate the scanner inside it. When it can accommodate the scanner, certainly you can use that chamber for near field. It depends upon the dimension.
Thank you. Thank you. It's very much information. Very good information, sir.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Okay. Thank you. Sir, next question is, will the NQX chamber is required during the measurement of microwave clocking?
Microwave plotting. What exactly you will be plotting that?
Microwave clocking.
Clocking?
Yeah.
I need to understand.
Microwave invisibility. Microwave invisibility, that is.
Microwave invisibility, can you please define it?
Yeah, sir, when we are just inserting some rays, then it is just going over the shape of, it is changing the over the shape, and again it is making less similar rays like this.
Well, see, any microwave measurement, when you are
sir, please close your mic. Satish Jain sir, please close your mic. Okay sir.
See, whenever we are doing any microwave measurements in the open, microwave will be bombarded with different noises and your results will change. It is always advisable, whenever microwave is radiating, whenever source is radiating, whenever you have a test which is radiating and which goes in the space, one should use an echo chamber for the better results. Otherwise, you will be confused in plotting those results.
Okay, next question is, may FSS absorbers replace PU foam absorbers?
Any absorber can replace PU foam absorbers till it is meeting the requirement of reflectivity at different various incident angles and for different frequencies, because we would need a broadband microwave absorbers. So any absorber which is having a broadband certainly can be used.
Okay, sir, next question is by Chitra. Same chamber can be used for near field and far field measurement?
I've already answered this for Dr. Satish Jain. If your chamber is having a dimension which can accommodate the scanner, which is having a height, certain height, maybe 3 meter, maybe 4 meter, maybe 5 meter, in addition to the height of a scanner, you have to have a more space for free space and for putting the absorbers. If your far field chamber can house, and if that scanner inside it, you can use it 100%.
Yeah, one question by Ayan Chatterjee, that if conical shape is chosen instead of pyramid, will it make a difference?
See, normally conical shape, this pyramidal shape is only required, and for this, I don't have much information, like whether if we are changing the shape, then we will have a different impact. Normally, pyramid shapes are only used.
Okay, one more question by Ardhindu Kundu, that reflectivity of anechoic chamber is possibly defined for normal incidence. However, up to what angle of incidence reflectivity criteria is still met?
Very good question. I have shown you an NRL arch anechoic chamber. In that, antennas are rotating on the arch. So practically, it goes, see, 90 degree, it cannot go left. And 90 degree, that other antenna will also not go right side. It can go up to 70 or 80 degree as per the dimension and weight of an antenna. So one can see, if we take a 100 degree span, there the incident angles are tested for 160 to 170 degree. Rest, it is also can be observed that it is for the side lobes or for the left signal it is receiving. But mostly, in a practical manner, we are testing absorber from 160 to 170 degree.
Yes, sir. One question by Rahul Jaiswal, IIT Kanpur. Okay. How position of quiet zone vary with frequency?
Position of quiet zone vary with frequency. Yes. You will see at different frequency, the dimension of your device under test will be different. At high frequency, it will be smaller. Similarly, let us take the transmitting side. A transmitting antenna will also be smaller at high frequency. So beam width will also be less. So smaller the antenna, smaller the size of quiet zone. So at when we are changing the frequency, the size of quiet zone is also changing. Far field is also changing. Hope I'm clear.
Yes, sir. and I think all the questions has been answered. Yeah, some of the repetitive questions are there. That's why I'm not asking all these questions. Yeah, okay. All I think you have cleared the queries of all the participants. Okay, thank you, sir. On behalf of IEEE Rajasthan subsection, on behalf of IEEE Antenna Propagation Society chapter, you are also the one of the part of that. On behalf of MNIT Jaipur, Government Women Engineering College, I thank you, and I thank you all the participants. I thank you all for such a nice session. And I think this is the first lecture of this type I have attended. I think most of the participants has attended this lecture for the first time. And just we are providing one certificate of appreciation. I think you can see on the screen.
Yes, it's looking great.
Yeah, as well as this type of means we are having the echo chamber installed by you up to 40 gigahertz, but most of the things I doesn't know. I think most of the participants has benefited from this session. The session was initially 1 hour. Now it has been completed more than 2 hours. And
oh my God, yes. Yes, it has gone. I think, hope you, everybody would like that. But I really appreciate and thank you very much for the society who has given me an opportunity to present this presentation. And I also feel glad that I'm part of this very important conference and seminars which you are conducting during this complete week. Thank you very much. If anybody has other questions, he can send me on my email ID, which I mentioned in the first slide. And somebody can also note it. It is mahesh.kala@jvmicronics.com, or they can collect my email ID and phone number from you and anybody organizing committee, and can send me any question on that.
Okay,
I'll be very happy to answer.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Take care. In the tough time, you're just here without the power, without the net. Yes, you have just delivered also, and for 2.5 hours you are continuously just sitting in the front without the power. The AC is not working.
Yes, AC is also not working.
Yeah, it's very tough to sit delivering lecture for continuously 2.5 hours.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Take care, everybody. Thank you, everyone.
Participants. And tomorrow's session will be at 2 p.m. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.